Hey everybody, my name is Glenn Andrew. I'm a new stress analyst here at Structures.aero, and I'm going to be taking y'all through what's new in Femap version 2020.1. So I think we've got everyone here now, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. All right, so today I'm going to give everyone a background of Structures.aero for anyone new who's tuning in, if this is their first webinar. Then I'm going to cover the new functionality and updates that Femap has made to its software, and then go through some demonstrations to show y'all what's new. So a little about us. We're a team of 15 engineers, several different types of degrees, and primarily we are aerospace, mechanical, and engineering science and mechanics majors. We all use Femap here and Nastran as well every day. So we are Femap and Nastran experts. Some recent projects we've been working on. We've got a couple engineers working on the Sierra Nevada Dream Chaser and also Blue Origin's New Glenn. And those are some really exciting projects going headed to space in a couple years. So in terms of aircraft, right now we have several engineers allocated to the Boom Supersonic Demonstrator, the XB-1. Which is it's pictured actually above, and that's they're trying to demonstrate their engineering efforts in order to build their commercial airliner, the Overture. We've got a lot of experience working on UAVs. Specifically, right now we're working on the Valancy C-50 and the Precision. Additionally, we do sometimes work on other projects such as dredges and just industrial projects where there's a little bit more expertise needed to solve complex problems like modal problems. In addition to offering engineering services, we are a Siemens value-added reseller. So we sell many different types of software, primarily computer-aided engineering and computer-aided design software. We offer two levels of Femap with NX Nastran training, as well as Fibersim training. Specifically, if anyone is interested, we are actually offering introduction training to Femap on March 3rd through 5th at our Sterling, Virginia office. If anyone's interested in that, there will be a contact at the end of this presentation that you can contact. We also provide software support to our software customers. So if our customers have a problem, they can always call us and we'll help them tackle whatever problem they're dealing with. If we don't know the answer, we go directly to the writers. Okay, so this is a fairly recent change to the way Femap is actually released. They started a six-month feature release cycle. So every 6 months, we get new features in Femap. And then in between those 6 months, there are maintenance releases. They're small, primarily for bug fixes and things like that. But every 6 months, you can expect a feature release. Which is exciting. The next version of Femap, I think, is due out in April, May-ish. So you'll hear from us again then. All right, so let's get into some of the changes. Okay, so Femap has actually redesigned all their icons. All 1600 icons have been modified to like fit a more consistent theme. And they've enhanced the contrast to make selection easier. And generally the goal has been to make them easier to figure out what this button's doing. So that should help new users. And then they've also increased the resolution of some of the icons, so it doesn't look as grainy if you're on a 4K display or if you're using the large icon option. Another user interface upgrade is that they've added you can now see the color of the entity that you're creating instead of having to click the palette button. Previously, there was a palette button you have to click to see the actual color, and now it's just right on this card, these cards. So it's just a small change, but it means a lot because it just saves you time. Okay, here's another user interface change when you're selecting results by checkbox. It's a small change, but there's a box on the right-hand side of this dialog, and it allows you to paste in a list. Similar to like if you're selecting elements, you can paste in a list of elements if you have them copied. Now you can do the same thing with when you're selecting checkboxes for results, or this is analysis cases, I'll show you this functionality in a demo, actually, but this is pretty helpful. Another function that they've added to Femap, they now let you display the coordinate system of the C-bush. And this is really helpful if you're trying to verify that your C-bushes are oriented properly. This functionality was actually included in another section of Femap under the custom tools, but now it's in a more seamless location underneath the view options. So you can get right to it and turn it on and off fairly fast now. All right, getting into some of the meat of the upgrades in 2020.1, Femap has upgraded their feature editing capabilities, leveraging some of their synchronous technology from Siemens. So in the meshing toolbox, there are now a couple different translate modes. Previously, there was just default. And now you have auto normal, which it automatically detects the normal vector to the surface you're trying to translate. And then interactive allows you to select a surface and then pick whatever vector you want. Previously, you had to select the vector, type in the value you wanted to translate it, and it was a little clunky. So now it's just a little bit more streamlined. In addition to this, they've also added some smart select options. This controls the other surfaces around the one that you select. It controls which ones Femap includes in the operation. So if you have a parallel surface that's offset from the one that you have selected, you can turn that on and off whether Femap will also move that. Similar with concentric or tangent edges. I'll demonstrate this later on. But this is a pretty helpful feature. And once you get used to using the feature editing, it's actually really useful. Okay, so this change is fairly self-explanatory. Basically, Femap has upgraded their blend removal tool. It now can take a little bit longer, but it's a more robust operation. So you can see here, we've got these blends in these corners. First, it removes all the corners, and then it removes the blends that are in the stepped region. So just a more robust blend removal feature. Another improvement to the geometry manipulation capabilities of Femap is that you can now specify the vector along which your washer is split. Previously, automatic is just default behavior. Femap just decides for you, but now you can specify the vector via like a vector selection dialog, or you can specify a curve and Femap will find the tangent vector to that curve at the closest point or the perpendicular vector to that curve. So they've just included a little bit more functionality for tailoring this split on the washer. All right, now we're getting into some pre-processing upgrades. Under tools, there's a new check mesh interference command where you can figure out if there are any elements that are intersecting with each other or interfering. This is pretty helpful. You've got like elements right on top of each other. It can be sometimes hard to figure out, you know, which ones are where, that type of thing. The cool thing about this feature is it checks line, planar, or solid elements, and then also checks the thickness of your line or planar elements. So it'll include the cross-section of these elements. When you run this check, it'll also let you create a group of these interfering elements. So it helps you isolate them and help you operate on these elements. Another tool that Femap has enhanced is the check some forces command. The upgrade to this is that now you can sum multiple load sets. Previously, if you wanted to sum three load sets, like figure out how many, the sum of all your forces in three load sets, you'd have to run this command three times. Now you can sum all the load sets individually, or you can select certain load cases you want, load sets you want summed. In addition to this, you can also send these summations to the data table. And it's important to note that this operation isn't summing all your load sets and the loads within those load sets. It's summing all the loads within each load set. So you can see here in the data table for load set one, it's got the total force, total moment. And then load set two, it's got the total force, total moment. It's not combining the load sets. Another enhanced pre-processing feature is the operation where you're creating a load from an output set. This is another one of those features where they've tried to just cut down on the amount of repetitive operations. So previously you can see the 2019.1 dialog, there's no option to select multiple output sets. And now you have the operation to select all of them or certain output sets. They've also included the ability to select face loads or the ability to create matching constraints, which is something specific if you're, for example, running a buckling run and you need those matching constraints. All right, here's one of my favorite improvements. It's really small, but it helps identifying some really annoying problems. Previously, the layer selection would just list certain layers. Now there's a little bit more option for listing these layers. You can list empty layers. For example, if you've deleted or moved things out of a layer and now it's empty and you're trying to clean your model up, it'll tell you which layers are empty and you can delete those. Missing layers, for those who aren't familiar with this, missing layers are layers that do not exist, but there are entities in your model that reference that layer. This has actually happened to me where I've had a model and I've deleted a hidden layer and then I can't find the entities in that layer because it's hidden. And even clicking the show all button that shows everything in your model, it won't show the entities on the missing layer. So now you can, this command will search through all the entities and find entities that reference layers that don't exist. And then it'll list out those layers that don't exist. Then you can create them, show them, and then move entities off of them. It's just going to be super helpful for that one time when you spend, you know, an hour trying to figure out what's going wrong with your model. Another improvement is that they've added the option for listing entities on layer and then also listing which groups and which views reference that layer. All right, this is an improvement over a 2019.1 feature where they improved the ability to sweep mesh along another mesh. The improvement here is that it'll now merge your nodes with the base mesh, which 2019 did not do. And this was just a customer requested feature, and it's now in 2020.1. Another improvement here is that sometimes if you're sweeping along two dissimilar meshes, Femap will get confused on which mesh you want to sweep along. So here's an example. If you now have the option to hide certain meshes and it will ignore that when it's sweeping. So here you can see the brown mesh is a little bit distorted in the middle and that shows up in the sweep. So if we zoom in, sweep the mesh, you can see the farther along you go, Femap is trying to match the brown mesh with the blue mesh. And that's why it's getting distorted towards the middle as you run along the sweep. So if you check on limit sweep to visible mesh, sweep the mesh, you can see that it's much more clean and it's not distorted. And then you can show that. And obviously it's not going to merge into this brown mesh because the nodes aren't coincident anymore, but it's just depending on what you're trying to do. Another command that's been rewritten is the edge and skin elements command. Previously you had to select the nodes that you wanted edge or skin elements on, and then you had to select the elements, and then that would tell Femap which nodes and elements you wanted. Now you can, it brings up the edge and face selection dialog, and you just select the edges or faces, and Femap automatically knows which nodes and which elements. It's just a more streamlined approach to this command. They've also added the offset option for edge element mesh, which is, it saves you a click or two when otherwise you'd have to go to like modify, update elements, update element offsets. So just a cleaner, faster way to get through this process. All right, another improvement is to the mesh connect rigid command. They've added the ability to target multiple source nodes with a target. And this is helpful if you're trying to stitch in like a fine mesh to a larger mesh. And it helps you smooth out the influence of that really coarse mesh on the fine mesh. And I'll show you here in this next picture, you can see that the original mesh options, which are still available, would really just sew it in and each coarse node would get a couple nodes and they wouldn't overlap. And now you can have a little bit more overlap and smooth out the influence of this coarse outer mesh on this fine mesh that we're trying to sew in there. All right. We primarily use Simcenter Nastran, so we're not as interested in the solver support updates. But if you are interested in using Femap with LS Dyna, Abacus, or Ansys, there are improvements. So make sure to go look at the full improvement list. But we are interested in the large ID ability. So now, if you have an ID above 100 million, it's now supported by Femap. Additionally, Femap knows what a monitor point is now, which is a Nastran feature, and you can create and manage and read and write these monitor points from Femap. Previously, I think you would have to just edit the Nastran files themselves, and we'll go over this in a second. All right, so monitor points give you the ability to sum forces in a model. So you can monitor like the shear in a beam at multiple points, and it'll sum up the shear or the bending moment. And it gives you a little bit of output that you can view without, you know, importing your FO6 file or like having to sum up like a free body or something. So there's three solutions supported, 101 and 103 for Nastran, and then also 144, which is the aeroelastic solution. Personally, I think this is helpful for me because it allows me to sum up aerodynamic model forces on the aero panels in my model and just check those, because in the past I've had to open up the FO6 file and then copy some of the data in there into Excel and operate. And this is way faster. So this is a big improvement. At least it matters to me a lot. And they also show up in the model tree now. So there's a couple more entities in the model tree. All right, this is a big change to Femap, especially for API writers, also to just people who are looking at output vectors. If you've ever looked at the plate bottom X normal stress, a lot of people I know have just memorized it as vector ID 7420. But now the Femap writers have chosen to shift this, just translate all these vector IDs down. And I think they're making room for other vector IDs. But this is something to be aware of, and if you're in the habit of like typing 7420 or 7421, it's different now. But it's even bigger impact on people who write APIs, because now if your API calls like 7420, it's wrong, and it's going to pull the wrong thing. So Femap has done a lot of work to try to minimize the impact of this. So there's a lot of different API scripts and functions that you can run to convert your code or check it for deprecated code. And then I think they've included support for your old APIs to still run, but there's a ton of functionality built into the API editor that'll make it pretty easy to switch these over, I think. So there's a lot more about this change in the Femap release notes, so make sure to check those if you're an API writer. Okay, and then a few miscellaneous updates. Grouping, when you create a group, now if there's not already an active group, the one that you just created is now created as it's your active group. It's similar to the way loads and constraints are handled, where you create a load and it's not your active load set. Another improvement is that when you create a load, it automatically expands the model info tree. Really small change, but it's nice that Femap is working on the small stuff too, because it's kind of annoying when you create your load to have to go over and expand the tree. Because like, I created this load because I needed to create my load definitions. So it's just a really small change that speeds up your everyday workflow. In addition to that, they've added the ability to copy load definitions from one set to another. So if I wanted to copy this temperature on surface, I could right click on it. It's a context sensitive command where I can right click and copy it to my, say, my spec 505C load set. Another small change, making Femap users' lives easier. Another change is that the model merge command now supports tables and analysis studies. Small change, but I'm sure there's people out there who really were looking for this. And then they've added the option to delete mid-side nodes if you're merging nodes. So this means like if you have a boundary of linear and then parabolic elements, like basically right up against each other, and the parabolic elements have midside nodes, but the linear elements don't have any elements or nodes to connect to those midside nodes. So it'll just identify those and delete them for you. They're called hanging midside nodes. I'm sure it takes some clever selection to delete those. So now it'll just do it for you. Okay, and that's all the changes. There are some potential projects in the works. I think Femap has already completed high-res support, including the new icons and multi-resolution support. We covered large IDs, and then I think they've updated some of the solutions, some of the solver supports. But these are just a few different topics that they've identified that they may go after in the future. Now I'm going to move into the demos and quickly run through these to show y'all what's actually been improved. Okay, so now we're in Femap. This is 2020.1. I've got 2019.1 to show y'all kind of what it was and what it is now. So if we go into the analysis manager, and let's say we want to delete a couple analysis sets, this brings up a checkbox selection dialog. And for us, it's super easy. For me, it's super easy right now to just select these all and delete them. But say you have like 100 analysis sets and you want to delete like a really weird combination, like every odd one, or like maybe just a random assortment that you know. You can now open up the standard selection dialog. And most of this functionality you probably won't use, but the big deal is that you can paste a list. So if you have a list in Excel that you keep there and just saved, you can copy that in. And then if you click OK, so let's say I have 1, 2, and 4 pasted in there from somewhere else from my clipboard. If I hit OK, I need to redo that. It'll automatically check them. Not a big deal for me, but for people dealing with like large lists, it's really helpful. All right, so here is the feature editing demo. I just have a random part. In the meshing toolbox, if you go to feature editing, default is a 2019 functionality. You can see you'd have to, you know, select your vector and enter your distance. Now you have the auto normal option, and it takes away the vector because it's just going to find your vector for you. So let's say I want to offset a surface by 1/4 inch. I can select it. We're going to turn off smart select for now, and it'll offset that. And notice that it only moved that surface. And that's what smart select is for, is that it helps you select different surfaces that are related to the one that you're trying to move. So if I undo this and turn on smart select and redo the operation, let's say we want to move, let's move the other face. I can select this surface and it moves several surfaces with it. It moves this offset surface, the one that's parallel but right behind it. And it also resizes this blend. And if I keep doing this, it'll keep operating on that until that encounters a problem. And clearly there's some weird stuff going on down here, and that's why the operation won't run anymore. Big improvement over 2019. All right, on the blend removal, I'll show y'all what this is. 2019, and I was trying to demo this feature, and I had a model in CAD, and then I brought it in, and 2019 kept removing all the blends. And I finally was able to make something that 2019 could not handle. So we're under meshing toolbox, feature removal, feature type blends. If we click remove, it doesn't remove anything. But if we go to 2020.1, in the same dialog, Femap actually removes the blends. So clearly they've delivered on their promise, and this feature is much more strong. All right, so I'm going to demo the mesh interference tool here under tools, and then check. It's mesh interference here, and I select all my mesh. Notice that I have a rigid element in here, this white element. If I click OK, it's going to highlight all these elements that are interfering and give me the option to create a group. Notice that it's not highlighting my rigid element. So that tells me that it's not checking that, which is not a big deal. It's just something to be aware of. All right, and then I'm going to demo the check sum forces tool here real quick. If we go to tools, check some forces, and let's just check some of the forces about the 0-0 axis. This is the new section here. Previously, it would only let you select a single load set, but now I can select all or just my own selection. And I'll show you here, I've got two load sets. One has two forces and one has just one force. So if we check the sum, I'll go ahead and select all, and then I'll send the summations to the data table. And it doesn't sum load set one and load set two, it sums the forces within that load set. So these two load definitions, it adds and then reports that, and then this load definition it adds. And clearly, you know, I have one pound in one direction, 1 pound in another direction. Here I have 2 pounds, so it's working properly. All right, I think that is it for my demonstrations. If anyone has any questions, feel free to contact me. My email is listed here. And then if you have any questions about software, pricing, or if you'd like to see a demo or attend one of our training classes, feel free to contact Marty, who is our director of sales, by email or phone. Either's fine.
APIs to convert to the new method. Is there any way to automatically convert, or do they have to manually update any of their older APIs?
I think there are programs or APIs that will, I think there are functions that you can run that will use the old vector IDs. So you have to change the function. Like, for example, they've just named a lot of them V2, and those use the new vector IDs, and V1 uses the old vector ID. So if you use V1, you should be fine. But if you choose to use the new vector IDs, you have to use version 2. If you still have a question, shoot me an email and I'll research it more and get back to you. Okay, and there's another question.
Do the graphics look softer?
Yes. I'm not sure if there was a change to the renderer. They have upgraded a lot of their icons, and they may have changed some of the colors that may make it look softer, but there was never anything about a rendering change in the release notes that I saw.
All right, thanks for doing this, Glenn. If anybody else has any questions, feel free to stay on and keep asking them. We will answer you by email. And you're welcome to email Glenn or Marty or myself. This is Jim Jeans. If you have any other questions or want to talk to us, and we'll talk to you all later.
Yeah, thank you guys for tuning in, and have a great day.